हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू ई पाठशाला। दिस इज़ डॉक्टर भारती गर्ग फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी, चंडीगढ़। फ्रेंड्स, इट इज़ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट अ पॉलिसी शुड हैव अ स्पेशल फोकस एंड दैट फोकस इज इट्स एजेंडा। इट थ्रू दिस एजेंडा इट ट्राइज टू अचीव सोल्यूशंस टू द वेरियस प्रॉब्लम्स प्रिवेलिंग इन सोसाइटी। बट हाउ दोज प्रॉब्लम्स come to the center stage of the governments and acquire the form of agenda for a policy. And thus, this module, friends, is going to discuss what are the problems, how those problems come to the center stage of the government's agenda, and how government come to form policies on these issues. Through various theories like pluralist theory, iron triangle theory, through advocacy coalition framework, through various subsystem theory, through various policy streams, we'll get to understand what all actors and factors play a role in setting the agenda for the governments to frame policies. These theories will inform you that how external and internal forces and various stakeholders, they come together and force the government to adopt a particular policy to set the agenda, and how government also sets its own agenda while framing a policy. So friends, we now start with the discussion in this module. What is agenda setting? Harold Laswell, one of the pioneers in policy sciences, posits that one of the main distinguishing characteristics of policy science was to help governments in deciding what are the issues that need government's attention, how to address them, and how to know what we have done. Laswell observed that problems faced by the government must be the central focus of a policy scientist, that is, when and how certain problems are taken into consideration by governments for policy making, as government chooses only certain problems among the universe of many problems that are vying for its attention simultaneously. The question then is why and how certain problems are picked over the others by government. This process wherein problems get government attention for decision making is called agenda setting. Thomas A. Birkeland defines agenda setting as the process by which problems and alternative solutions gain or lose public and elite attention. According to Brian Jones and Frank Baumgartner, agenda setting is the process by which information is prioritized for action and attention allocated to some problems rather than others. Agenda setting is necessarily associated with political power. There are many groups which are involved in the process of grabbing government's attention towards a particular problem and pitching their alternatives for its solution. The resultant problem and its solution that emerge out of this contestation among the groups are taken up by the government for decision making. It is obvious that groups which are relatively powerful are ultimately able to influence this decision making aspect of government. Thus, this wielding of political power by the actors engaged in policy process to effectively guide the course of policy debate also becomes an important area of study in agenda building process. The questions that come to our mind are, who are these actors in policy making process? What are their ways to influence agenda setting? Under what circumstances government takes decisions regarding certain problems? Where does policy come from? How and why policy changes? To answer these questions, various models are developed by policy scholars and theories developed by them would be discussed now. These are essentially theories of policy process which explain the complex process of agenda setting. Firstly, from pluralism to iron triangle. Scholars advocating pluralism believe that power in society is not concentrated. In fact, it is diffuse, fragmented among individuals and groups like political parties and interest groups, and there is an equal balance of power between interest groups. All groups thus share a portion of power among themselves, and it's their simultaneous activities which ultimately determine whose political preferences would be adopted. This optimistic idea of pluralism regarding power organization in society, whereby policies emanate from the contestations of the groups wielding power, was criticized by the Iron Triangle theorists. Iron Triangle theorists symbolize their idea of power organization in society by triangle, whereby its three nodes are represented by Congress, bureaucracy, and special interest groups.
According to these theorists, the solutions offered by these actors do not necessarily represent social welfare and are actually forwarded to suit their narrow interests. This change in approach came as a result of case studies done by US analysts in the sectors of water, agriculture, and public works in 1950s and 60s. They observed that congressional committees, executive agencies, and producer groups formed a close alliance and were instrumental in policy-making process. This alliance was very stable according to these theorists because all actors involved had similar interests, and in words of Peters, they shared a symbiotic relationship where each actor in the Iron Triangle needs the other two to succeed. According to Iron Triangle theorists, participants in policymaking arena were very limited, and it is here that one can see a shift from pluralist tradition. Now, subsystems theory. Due to change in US politics during 1970s, emergence of post-material values like politics of issues such as environment rather than mainly economic interest, the prevalence of protest, the questioning of authority, and the loss of certainty and optimism in solving policy problems, which fractured the consensus behind the power of producing groups and the practice of bureaucratic government, made the Iron Triangle irrelevant to explain these new circumstances emerging in policy process. Instead of Iron Triangles, there are now issue networks or webs of influence. Thus, in 1970s, the scholars started arguing that unlike in Iron Triangle theories, the policy process was more open, involving many other actors. The proponents of this wave of thought were called the subsystems theorists, who emphasized on the further decentralization of policy process. Among the subsystem theorists, Hugh Hecklow belongs to one of the earliest lot. Now, Hugh Hecklow, issue networks and technopoles. Hecklow argued that policy environment was not dominated by few participants who operated in closed circles as proposed by Iron Triangle theorists. Instead, there are fairly open networks of people that increasingly fringe upon government as policy process is very dynamic and increasingly complex. He criticized the Iron Triangle theories to be too simple to capture the emerging realities of policy-making field, and disagreed with Iron Triangle theorists over reliance on the stability and predictability of group, department, legislative committee stronghold on policy process, and emphasized on the fragmentation of policy process. Elaborating on his concept of issue networks further, Hecklow says that issue networks comprise of a large number of participant groups, public and private organizations, and ordinary citizens that have entered the policy stream with quite variable degrees of mutual commitment or of dependence on others in their environment. In fact, it is almost impossible to say where a network leaves off and its environment begins. Participants move in and out of networks constantly. These actors informal alliances or shared knowledge group called issue networks around issues on which they agree. Hecklow observed that these issue networks are fluid and unpredictable in nature. Active citizens who are concerned with particular policies regularly venture into these groups. The size and influence of these groups keeps on changing depending on the issue around which they are organized and the attention gathered by it. Adding another dimension to this concept of issue networks, Hecklow posits that under these issue networks, a few set of people who have specialized technical knowledge about particular policies called technopoles are more influential. This expertise of the technopoles made them reference point of the elected officials for policy inputs. Hecklow observed that the emergence of issue networks dominated by technopoles have widened the distance between policymakers and citizens. He observed that as the complexity of the issue increased, so did the distance between citizens and policymakers. This poses a dilemma in Hecklow's theory. On one hand, while describing the benefits of issue networks, he claims that they reflect the will of citizens and there is no power center which solely takes policy decisions. On the other hand, he observes that policy experts in issue networks are more influential than the general participants. Besides, there is no clarity how the Iron Triangle and issue network model are different. For example, Jordan contends that issue networks are simply Iron Triangles with a greatly increased group population. Another set of criticisms refer to its theoretical weakness and the theory being amorphous. It is contended that if everything involves issue networks, how one can explain the discrete behavior and actions? Despite criticisms, it is to the credit of Heckler that he dismissed the notion of rigidity in terms of number of actors involved and their accessibility in the agenda setting process. The model, to an extent, rightly responded to changing political scenario in the United States, and through the application of the concept of issue networks, emphasized on the permeability and dynamic nature of policymaking arena. Now we are going to discuss Paul Sabatier's Advocacy Coalition Framework. Another milestone in agenda-setting policy literature is Paul Sabatier's work. On the lines of Heckler, Sabatier argued that policy process is ongoing, dynamic and complex due to participation of large number of actors, and that policymaking occurs by the continuous interaction of policy subsystems. He also differed from Iron Triangle theories and argued that policy arena is permeable and unpredictable. Sabatier then elaborates on the model of individual from social psychology perspective and explains how this in turn shapes the working of policy subsystems. The Advocacy Coalition Framework believes that actors have core normative beliefs on the basis of which they coalesce around an issue, and they are hard to change. Advocacy Coalition Framework model of individual is based on the concept of bounded rationality, and it assumes that individuals have limited abilities to process stimuli, and therefore they rely on beliefs as the principal heuristic to simplify, filter and sometimes distort stimuli. The perceptual filters of actors are the result of their pre-existing beliefs, and this leads to difference in their views about any information since they differently perceive realities around them. This difference is the basic cause of conflict and competition between different coalitions. He also includes the prospect theory in his Advocacy Coalition Framework, which says that individuals remember their defeats more than their victories. This causes distrust among the actors, and they think of each other as more powerful and evil. Sabatier calls this phenomenon as devil shift. The devil shift increases the density of two members within the same coalitions and exacerbates conflicts across competing coalitions. Perceptual filters also tend to screen out dissonant information and reaffirm conflicting information, thus making belief change quite difficult. Sabatier considers beliefs as the causal driver of political behavior and says that policies are broadly translation of those beliefs. Accordingly, he then describes the three-tiered hierarchical structure of these belief systems. At the highest level are deep core beliefs, which are normative, product of lifelong socialization process, stable and very difficult to change. The second level is called policy core beliefs, specific to a subsystem, and are applications of deep core beliefs. Policy core beliefs are used to form coalitions and coordinate activities among its members. At the lowest level, we have secondary beliefs, which are further narrower in scope and are empirically based. These are less resistant to change, and changing them requires less evidence and fewer agreements among subsystem actors. The above detailed explanation of belief systems is crucial to ACF, as one of its main underpinning convictions is that the policy participants continuously strive to get their beliefs converted into actual policies before their opponents could do so. Thus, ACF provides us an important tool to bring some order in the study of highly complex field of policy making. Advocacy Coalition Framework, that is ACF, is also important as it explains in detail how and why a policy changes. Coalition Framework identified two paths of policy change. Policy-oriented learning. The belief of a group changes continually in response to change in socio-economic and political environment around it. New informations have an impact on secondary beliefs of a group because secondary beliefs are more susceptible to change as compared to policy core beliefs, and they adjust their beliefs accordingly. This path of policy change takes longer period as compared to the second path. The second way which can cause change in policy is through external perturbations or shocks consisting of changes in socioeconomic conditions, regime change, outputs from other subsystems, or disaster. External shocks are capable of changing policy core beliefs and often lead to rapid changes in policies. They can also lead to replacement of a dominant coalition by a minority coalition in a policy subsystem. The third part, added later, leading to policy changes through internal shock. This happens when existing policies fail disastrously due to the actors internal to policy subsystems. The fourth path for policy change in advocacy coalition framework is labeled as negotiated agreements, involving policy course changes crafted among previously warring coalitions. This happens when coalitions feel that policy stalemate is unacceptable and only way out is through negotiations with other rival coalitions. The strength of Sabatier's advocacy coalition framework is that it explains reasons for both stability and rapid change in policy process theoretically. Advocacy coalition framework also gives us an important tool to contrast and simplify hundreds of actors into coalitions. However, there are many who have highlighted its limitations also, like non-clarity about the role of ideas and self-interest in the policy process. Sklager has criticized it and said it does not address the collective action problem. According to Jordan and Greenway, advocacy coalition framework has not elaborated upon the role of public opinion in general in policy-making process. Subsystem theorists brought a change in the way policy process was seen traditionally. They sought to move away from the iron triangle paradigm because they felt that it was inadequate to explain the new changes that polity was going through. Subsystem theorists argued that new models are needed to explain the policy process, which is getting more decentralized and fragmented. According to them, policy proposals emerged from multiple points and policy process was no more a rigid and impermeable arena. They considered subsystems as the most appropriate unit to analyze policy process. However, Heckler's findings also exposed that the elites were still in control of policy formulation process. He found that technical experts who had specialized knowledge about a particular policy dominated policy subsystem and was more instrumental in policy process. Paul Sabatier, moving a step ahead of Heckler, increased the number of participants in his model. He also said that the complexities in the interaction among the participants have increased and advocacy coalitions are an important tool for analysis since they help in simplifying the categorization process. Now, Kingdon's policy streams. John Kingdon's research on policy process is a path-breaking work. He examined health and transportation policies of 1970s in USA. It is one of the few works that treat policy process holistically by examining the importance of individual actors, ideas, institutions, and external effects. Kingdon emphasized on the dynamic nature of policy process and rejected the notion of its stability. According to him, policy outcomes were a result of the continual interplay of all elements in the policy process. To answer the basic questions relating to agenda setting, Kingdon came up with three streams of processes, that is problems, policies and politics. These streams in his garbage can model are supposed to answer as to how governmental agendas are set. They are defined as follows. Problem stream. According to Kingdon, problem definition is very important for agenda setting as it determines the enormity of an issue. If definition of a problem projects it as acute or pressing, the chance of its getting into agenda increases. The outcome is also significantly determined by problem definition. Policy stream. In this stream, policy alternatives are coined by various participants to address new problems that emerge. These participants can be clubbed into two clusters, that is visible and hidden. Here we have what Kingdon calls policy primeval soup, inspired by Cohen, March and Olson's garbage can, where many ideas float around, bumping into one another, encountering new ideas and forming combinations and recombinations. From this soup, alternatives move further and get converted into viable policy options. Now, the political stream. Political stream is also an important component of the model, which is crucial in deciding which problems would be prioritized in agenda setting. Political events like elections and national mood have their own dynamics and they follow their own trajectory in setting policy agendas. For example, a new administration would be having its own perception regarding some problems. Accordingly, it would pursue those problems which may not have been at the radar of its predecessor. Now, coupling and policy windows. According to Kingdon, for an item to get on decision agenda, it is necessary that these three above mentioned streams get combined and are pushed through a policy window. Kingdon calls this process of the streams coming together as coupling. He considers the role of policy entrepreneur as prominent in coupling these streams. Kingdon's garbage can model provides us with a theoretical framework which is thorough in its details, elaborating on the importance of multiple determinants of policy agenda, such as ideas, institutions, individuals, and external processes. It envisions policy process as dynamic and ongoing, where all the elements involved are continuously shifting and changing, and policy outcome is the result of their constant interplay. Kingdon's model is a welcome advance over rationalist mode of policy analysis. Rationalist theories of agenda setting advocated that in any situation the problem is clearly defined, and through cost-benefit analysis, the outcomes that are preferable are also determined clearly. Contrary to this, garbage can model viewed that there is no consensus on the definition of problem or on preferred outcomes. The model views the policy-making arena as an organized anarchy where participants come up with their own set of different solutions. These are then dumped into garbage can along with problems. When a problem rises on the agenda of decision makers, they, instead of maximizing on preferences, search for solutions from this garbage. Kingdon's model is also important as it explains the change that a policy undergoes due to changes in certain political and policy dynamics. Now, incrementalism and punctuated equilibrium models. One of the important questions that agenda setting literature has always sought to answer is how and why a policy changes. For a long period of time, the most widely discussed concept to answer this question was incrementalism. Charles Lindbom, through his study of trade unions and welfare policies of industrialized countries, reached to a conclusion that policy change as a result of slow adjustment and limited variation in already existing policies. Lindbom's incremental approach was in reaction to rationalist perspective, which assumed that decision making can be done by entirely rational way after weighing cost and benefit of available alternatives. The limitations of the theory of incrementalism are many, but the most important among them is that it is incapable of explaining rapid changes in a policy. Baumgartner and Jones, in their work Agendas and Instability in American Politics, observed that apart from stability, there are also periods of rapid changing in policy making in USA, to which they termed these periods as punctuated equilibria. The importance of punctuated equilibrium model lies in the way it connects various elements of policy making into one dynamic framework. There are five such elements that this model connects: institutions, interests and networks, social and economic factors, individual actors and ideas. This model has also been criticized as it fails to predict the time when change or rapid shift in policy would occur. Secondly, the model assumes that under favorable conditions, people outside the policy process can gain advantage and push for new agendas. However, despite these criticisms, the importance of punctuated equilibrium model cannot be overstated. The model is an advance over incrementalism, and it explains that changes in policy are not always incremental, they are also rapid. The model also is an improvement over rationalist model, as it explains that irrational factors can also lead to rapid changes. The most important contribution of the model is that it helps us to reflect on the complex relationship between institutions, interests, networks, social and economic factors, individual actors, and ideas that exist in policy-making process.
To conclude the discussion, friends, I would like to inform you that in this module, we discussed about agenda setting. We discussed about various theories of agenda setting and the role of ideas in setting the agenda. We also discussed how these theories and ideas play a role in the agenda setting for policy making. We have come to learn that various stakeholders, political parties, civil society, various political parties, pressure groups, business groups, they play a major role in setting the agendas. Friends, policy making is a complex process, and setting the agenda for the policy is further complex. Because if the agenda is not right, the policy is not going to be implemented effectively and the results would be zero. Thus, it is very important that agenda for the policy be set in the right manner so that the effects of the policy can be achieved in an effective manner and the benefits could reach to the actual masses in the society. Thank you.